Today is August 6, 2013, and we are at the Northern California studio of rock star and radio personality and novelist Greg Kihn, longtime ASCAP member, for a video for the ASCAP Living Video Archive, made possible by a generous grant from the Cain Foundation. Okay. Thank you, Greg, for being here and letting us into your place here. Growing up in Baltimore, that's where you grew up.
Right? Oh, yeah.
You came of age with both rock and roll and the folk revival?
Well, the folk revival was going strong right before the Beatles hit. And I had gotten a guitar. Actually, we found a broken guitar. My mom found a broken guitar in the alley, and she brought it home. I got it fixed. It was a horrible guitar. But then I went down to a pawn shop and bought an actual guitar. So I could play three or four chords by the time the Beatles were on Ed Sullivan. And you know, I'd been playing, Hang Down Your Head, Tom Dooley, and stuff like that. And they had a coffee house in Baltimore, where on Sunday nights they had a hootenanny, and anybody could get up and play. So me and my cousin started this little folk group, the two of us, you know, and we would get up there, we'd go and sign up on a Sunday night and get up, and that's where I kind of, I learned the ropes and got in front of people and enjoyed playing in public.
What were the songs that you were singing?
Oh boy, we were singing some moldy stuff. Let's see. Well, Tom Dooley was big. MTA, I remember that. Green Fields.
Oh, yeah.
Once there were green fields. Used to do a couple of Ian and Sylvia tunes. And of course, right around that time, Bob Dylan came out with Freewheeling. And a good friend of mine bought that album, and it knocked me out. So immediately I started doing stuff like Blowing in the Wind. I got one of those harmonica braces. And that's when I started writing songs, you know? I was a devotee of the folkies and the guys that were songwriters. And, I thought, what the heck? You know, those first songs are pretty horrible. But it's important that you write them. You know what I mean? Because that's a muscle that you want to use, your songwriting creativity. And like I'm going to say, probably the first 2 years of songs I wrote were awful. But, I was serious about it. I used to go out and cut demos. My mother, of all people, when I was 16, she sent a demo that I cut in the bathroom of our house on a tape recorder, a little reel-to-reel tape recorder, of a song that I had written. She sent it into WCAO radio contest, and I won. I won the contest, and I didn't even know that she submitted me. I won an electric guitar, a typewriter, and a stack of records. All three things figured into my eventual career.
Wow, so you really have to...
It was karmic, wasn't it? You know, growing up in Baltimore in those days, I was a sponge for music. And we had great radio. You know, I remember Fat Daddy. Good Cougalooga Mooga, Papa Diddy, Baltimore City. You know, we had guys like that were jive guys on the radio, Commander Hot Rod. And I had a love for the radio. So growing up, I used to keep a little transistor. Remember those little cheesy ones? I used to keep it under the pillow after my mom thought I was asleep. I'd be under the covers listening to WCAO and, Bird is the Word and all those weird songs. I was just crazy for that. Then the Beatles hit. I must have been 13, maybe 14. And I saw him on Ed Sullivan that magical Sunday night, and I thought, this is what I got to do. I got to start a band now. I got to plug in. And eventually I made my way out to California, and I did exactly that. But the beautiful thing about it was the Beatles inspired an entire generation. You know, in my radio years, I interviewed lots of guys, Neil Schon, Steve Miller, you name it, Boz Scaggs. All of them said, yep, saw the Beatles on Ed Sullivan, changed my life. And ironically, it all comes back because that whole moment in time is covered in my new novel, Rubber Soul, which comes out September 3rd, and you can pre-order it at gregkihn.com. It's really something different. It's a novel with the Beatles as characters in the novel. So I don't think that's ever been done before, but if it has, I never heard of it. It's a wonderful read. You don't have to be a Beatles maniac, and you don't have to be a baby boomer. It's kind of a coming-of-age novel, too. And it's, you know, it's a good adventure, and it's a good ripping yarn with a bang-up ending and an assassination attempt in Manila by the Marcos family on the Beatles. So it really is got a lot of stuff going on.
All right, don't give it away.
Don't want to give it away, but it's you got to read this thing, Rubber Soul.
I'm looking forward to that. So was your family musical?
You know, my mother was. She played a piano, and when she was a young girl, she had entertained thoughts of being a singer. And she sang, you know, those torch songs. And she would sit down occasionally, very rarely, but on occasion she'd sit down and do one of her songs on the piano, and it was pretty dramatic. My dad didn't have a musical bone in his body, and my sister wasn't really musical. You know, it seemed to me like all of my friends were musical back in, everybody that I knew around me played the guitar or the banjo or did something. And, you know, we were young. This was a great way to meet chicks. You know what I mean? Like, you're playing down at the local CYO coffee house, Catholic Youth Organization coffee house. You know, and I'd make $40 on a Sunday night. I'd go down. That's a lot of money for a guy back in those days. And you'd meet chicks. They'd come up to you. Oh, I loved your song. Or, you know, I mean, it was wonderful. It was a magical time. I say growing up as a musician and coming of age as a songwriter was the best time of my life.
Wow. Was there any formal music education?
No, none whatsoever. I can't read music. I mean, here's a guy, look at it. I made 18 albums. I had a bunch of hit records. Wrote all those songs. Never read music. You know, I just put down the chords. I think Steve could read a little music, but I don't think anybody in the band was really what you go. Now, my son, Rye, can read like a demon. He's a jazz guitar major, graduated from college, so he can read, sight read really well. But me, you know, all the things that I've done, and I think this is really the crux of the interview right here. All the things that I have done, whether it's songwriting, you know, being a front man for the Greg Kihn Band, writing the novels, being on the radio for 17 years, no matter what the endeavor was, it always came from the heart. And it was something like, I wasn't good at any of these things, or I didn't know that I wasn't good. I could just do it. You know what I mean? Like when I first started doing radio, I had no idea. I just kind of followed my heart. And I knew that, you know, all I had to do was stick with it, and it would be good, because it would be me. You know, I didn't have a shtick. And that's kind of been the way it's been for my entire career, whether it's songwriting. I just write what's on my mind, write what's in my heart. You don't try to write hits, or at least I never did. And every time you do, you miss the mark. It's the song that you dash off in 15 minutes. It's the idea that you got in the back of a cab. It's the idea you got when you were hanging out with your buddies last night, and you just jot down the idea. That's the magic. You start with the magic, and then you write the song. The songwriting part, you can learn. That's a craft that you can learn. You'll get better as the years go by. And that's kind of what happened with me. But I started with the spark. You know what I mean? And that was, and I think it was the same thing with radio and the same thing with writing the novels.
Did you go to college?
Yeah, I spent two wonderful years at Community College of Baltimore. The greasy spoon of academe is what we called it. Kind of like the McDonald's of colleges. And I took, ironically, I was in the radio and TV curriculum. And that was fun because they had a little radio station on campus, and you could get it two blocks away, but it was really cool. And they had a little TV station, and you know, we put on productions, and it was a lot of fun.
Wow, wow. And you had, did you have a rock band in Baltimore at all?
No, I was a folky when I was in Baltimore. I was a songwriter, and you know, I realized that my future was elsewhere, but you know, it was so easy living in your hometown. When I first came to California and I met the guys in Earthquake and Joel Turtle, who's still my manager, and Matthew Kaufman, the energy, I mean, these guys were doing stuff. They had gigs to play. You know, they were making records. It was, you know, it wasn't like you were dreaming about doing it. These guys were really doing it.
So what made you decide to come to California?
A couple of late night phone calls from Alan Mason, telling me how pretty the girls were and how good the dope was, and you got in the sunshine and you the beach, and you gotta come, man. It's great.
I'm from Baltimore.
Yeah, and I get these late night phone calls from Alan, and he's, "What are you waiting for, man?" He was working at A&M Records as a promo guy, but he knew all the A&R guys. He said, "Come on out. I could probably get you some demos cut for A&M. And we'll just go from there, you know, cast your fate to the wind and seek your fortune." I think that's how we put it. And I did. I got off the plane. I didn't know a soul except for Alan and the guys I met. The first day I was there, I met Joel. I met a couple of guys. And, you know, we've been lifelong friends and partners ever since. But what I loved about these guys was the energy. When I got there, you know, I met John Dukas from Earthquake and Eddie Money that same night down at a nightclub. And I couldn't believe it. They were so pumped up, you know what I mean? They had gigs, they were doing demos, they were auditioning for Bill Graham and record companies, and there was something to do. It was action. And that really appealed to me after all those years in Baltimore, which there really wasn't much action. We managed to play the occasional gig, but one day there was a place called the Long Branch Saloon, and it was owned by a guy named Malcolm, and Earthquake was the house band there. And then when they left, vacated that. Eddie Money and the Rockets were the house band. Then they vacated that spot, and Malcolm said, "Man, it's too bad," because I was a folkie and I'd open for bands. He says, "It's too bad you don't have a band, or you guys could be the house band. I need somebody Sunday night." And I lied. I just said, "Oh, I got a band. Yeah. I got a band." Actually, I had a bass player, Steve Wright. That was it. And we put together a band in 1 week, and that band stayed together for 10 years and had a whole bunch of hit records. Isn't that amazing? And, you know, that's rock and roll, though. You know, if you'd have had auditions and taken 6 months, it would have been different. This was like, hey, let's throw it together and go.
So at that Long Branch Saloon, I guess,
we cut our teeth. I remember the first gig we did. I remember the first song we did. It was "The Kids Are All Right" by The Who. And we went out there and we were, you know, green, never played a gig. In fact, that was the first rock gig I ever played. And we just winged it. And it was so much fun. You know what I mean? We wound up jamming Bob Marley songs and Bob Dylan stuff and all kinds of weird things. Because we only had that much material. We had this much time to fill, so right. The old taffy pool.
Right, right, right. So you got lots of experience doing that.
One of the things that I think songwriters know innately, you look around at some of the great songs, the ones that have endured. A lot of them were written very quickly. For instance, I was just playing on my internet radio show the other day. I was just playing "Free, All Right Now." That was an encore. They didn't have a song. They just went out there and jammed. And Paul Kossoff just bam, ba-dum, bam. And then the guy improvised the words. And that's how that song was written. And think of it. It was like 30 years later. It's still getting airplay. Or 40 years later, it's still getting airplay. That's what I'd like to do. And you know, with the breakup song, that's the same thing. We wrote it very quickly and didn't know it was going to be a hit. Everybody thought Valerie was the hit from that album, believe it or not, rock and roll. But shows you what we knew. The radio immediately gravitated to the breakup song. And I learned a lesson. I learned that the songs that just pop out, that seems as if they're floating in the air and you channel them, are the great ones. The ones that you sweated over for 3 weeks, a lot of times it didn't even make the album. And some of the great songs were written that way. You know what I mean? Like if you read the Goffin King story, you know, or how they wrote Will You Love Me Tomorrow for the Shirelles, which he'd gone bowling and she had to go to bed early. So she wrote the music and left the tape out. Please write lyrics to this by the morning because we have a thing with the Shirelles. And he just sat down and he wrote, Will You Still Love Me Tomorrow? Which one of the great lyrics of all time. Just like that. So that's the magic I'm talking about. I think most songwriters strive to get that magic.
So you're beginning to make a name for yourself at this Long Branch Saloon. You have these friends, including Joel, who's standing behind us.
So. Uh-huh. We're still together after all these years. Isn't that amazing? You know, most people have fallings out or falling outs. And you know, for one reason or another, all the other bands dropped off and, you know, this guy was pissed at that guy. But somehow over the years, Joel and I managed to hang in there. And he's been a great lifelong friend. And his life advice to me is always on the money. I don't take it half the time, but it's always on the money.
So you had a connection at A&M.
Yeah.
That didn't happen.
No, they did pay for some demos, and I think they gave me $500 as a development fee. And I did do some demos for them. It just didn't click. A&M at the time, Alpert and Moss, and it was Almo Music. And it was run by Paul Williams. And he was a very commercial guy. You know, he wanted me to write songs like Tie a Yellow Ribbon Around the Old Oak Tree. And I wasn't. I was more, you know, I was in a different thing. I just didn't fit in with the Almo people. So they gave me the money. They were really nice. But they let me go. I wound up coming up, and I was in L.A. for about a year. And I wound up coming up to Berkeley. I didn't have anything going. And this whole time, Earthquake had been playing, and Matthew and Joel had been putting together Beserkley Records, and boom, I just walked into a scene. It was a good scene.
Was there a particular sensibility there? I mean, there was, you know, I mean, that album that put everybody on the map, I guess, was the Chartbusters.
Yeah.
It seemed to have a certain kind of sound and sensibility that was different than pretty much anything that was happening.
Yeah. You know, I'm proud of those early days because we were like between Sun Records, after Sun, with the great independent labels, kind of came and went, you know, Monument with Fred Foster and King, and it was a lot of them. But over the years, there really wasn't that great rock and roll label. And I thought because we predate Stiff. And all of those independent, in fact, I think we were the first modern day independent rock and roll label. And we were literally flying by the seat of our pants. I shrink wrapped my first album. I personally shrink wrapped all what 20,000 or whatever we sold in the back room of Rather Rip Records, which was my day job working as a record clerk. And it was funny because when we went in to do Chartbusters, it was like, okay, next, you know, we were working after hours. Glenn Kolotkin was doing the knobs, and it was like everybody, the bands were ready, and you had to, you know, had your song ready, and then, you know, everybody was like, it took like 2 or 3 days to do the whole album top to bottom, and it was a load of fun. Really felt like you were part of something. And then as soon as that sucker came out, I started hearing it on KSAN. You know, and people were gravitating that, first of all, Roadrunner, everybody loved. Friday on My Mind was a big hit. All the Right Reasons was getting airplay. It was really an interesting time. And, of course, in those days, FM radio played album cuts. You know, it wasn't all consultants. It was, they'd look around like, oh, that station in St. Louis is playing Greg Kihn. Why don't we play him? You know, and it was easier. It was just a different world then.
I mean, you definitely broke through, I guess, with All Right Reasons. I mean, that was the, I know you had a couple of tunes on.
Yeah. Well, it wasn't until the second album, really, Greg Kihn again, For You got a ton of airplay. And that was the Springsteen cover. And that just kind of launched us in a different direction. Bruce was real inspirational, and he started doing my version live, which was very flattering. And he gave me Rendezvous, started showing up backstage at gigs. I was playing at the Roxy in LA, and Bruce comes by. And here's this guy. I mean, he's a mega star. No entourage, no roadies, no bodyguards, nothing. He just shows up by himself, comes in, pays to get in, which is phenomenal, sits down at a table on the side of the stage, watches the show just like anybody else, and he comes backstage, complete gentleman, and he said he really liked our version of For You, and he was doing our version live, and would we be interested in another tune? And I said, well, hell yeah. You know, when the boss gives you a song, you just say, yes, yes, sir. So he gave me Rendezvous. And it's a funny story because we'd written down the lyrics on some napkins and at the gig, and I put them in my pocket, went out, played a second show, sweated into like pulp. And I had no idea what the lyrics were. So they see Bruce, or his manager sent me a cassette of the song Rendezvous. But not known for his diction, Bruce is very hard to understand, especially a demo. And he had this line in the bridge, it sounds like he's singing, we desire so much more than squirrels. And I knew it couldn't be squirrels. I knew it couldn't be, but I didn't know the lyrics, and I didn't get to see Bruce until after. So I kind of went in there and I just kind of flubbed through it. We desire so much more as well. You know what I mean? I didn't know it turns out the lyrics were, we desire so much more than this girl. But in the world of Springsteen, we desire so much more than this girl turned into squirrels. Anyway, it was kind of funny. And the next time I saw Bruce, he said, yo, Greg, there are no squirrels in that song. But those were magical times. That was right around the second and third album. As a matter of fact, Remember was out, I think, right when that was the Next of Kin album that had just come out when Bruce came to the Roxy. And, you know, I started popping in. Like, if he played the community theater, I'd pop in, say hi. You know, back in those days, it was a different vibe, and I think it was less competitive. Everybody was more friendly. You know what I mean? Like, if you popped in to see your favorite band at the Keystone, you could just pop in backstage and say hello, and, you know, it wasn't all this distance, and, you know, there wasn't all this weirdness. I mean, you know, for me, half of rock and roll is social. It's hanging out with people that I love and playing music, and it's a good thing.
So your band stuck together for 10?
Yeah, that first incarnation for 10 years, yeah.
Did the Beserkley artists go out on package tours? Did they be right at the beginning?
We did, yeah. We went out. Me and the canoes. Me and the Rubenews went out toward Europe. In fact, we got the Paradiso poster right here in this room somewhere. And it's the Rubenews, Greg Kihn Band, and the Rubenews at the Paradiso in Amsterdam, one of my favorite clubs. And I remember this night like it was yesterday. We had so much fun. I played a million gigs with Earthquake. You know, those were fun times. You know, we had gotten to the point where it's like you put one foot in front of the other. You're, you know, taking baby steps. We became one of the most popular bands in Berkeley. And then we branched out. We were well known in San Francisco in the South Bay. And then we were one of the big popular bands in the Bay Area. And then we kind of branched down to LA. And we started playing down there. And it was all very much a progression. And it all was built on hard work, touring, we toured our butts off. And it seemed like I wrote a song every day. You know, when you're young and bulletproof, you're with your band on the road, you literally write a song every day. And some of those songs weren't bad. A lot of them made it onto albums.
So how did you do it? You just sat down with your guitar and just
Wrote
it out?
Yep. Well, you know, it starts with the magic. It starts with the idea. What's the spark? You know, I might be at breakfast. You know, this is how, for instance, Hard Day's Night was written. They were at breakfast and Ringo goes, you know, he's real tired. What's wrong, Ringo? Oh, it was a hard day's night. And, you know, bingo, it goes off in John Lennon's head. So a lot of the stuff that we wrote was right there. You know, like somebody would say something in the van and I'd write it down. Or I hear a piece of conversation or I get an idea. Ideas can come from anywhere. I think that the pro songwriter keeps his mind open at all times. The pro songwriter is always open. You think in terms of songs. And I know guys that do this. Everything you say is a song. You know what I mean? They'll, oh, wow, let me write that down. Everything you say is a song. Man, that's a song. No, I'm still, you know what I mean. And once you, one, you're thinking like that, everything becomes a song. That's when you're really hitting your stride, man. That's good stuff.
So the first really big hit was the breakup song.
Breakup song, yeah. 1981, got top 10. Really broke through for us. You know, we had been bubbling under for years. And believe it or not, that was our seventh album. Now, how many groups make seven albums before they have their first top 10 record? Right. That many. You know, that was the beauty of being on Beserkley. And, you know, we had been going one step at a time, so our foundation was solid. I could continue to make albums and not have hit records and get FM airplay and tour the country and play places like, you know, Bogart's and Cincinnati and the Agora and, you know, the Paradise in Boston and all those clubs all over the country that were just like the Keystone where we were, you know, ruling. So it was a time of hard work. I keep saying that hard work thing. But, you know, it wasn't hard work. It was fun. It was fun work.
You were having a great time.
Oh, I you know what? I do it all again.
You always had a very nice way with cover songs. I remember, you know, hearing you interviewed on WNEW.
Yeah.
In New York. And it was just great because you were really bubbling over with happiness.
Yeah.
Doing your favorite tune.
Yeah.
I don't remember which one, whether it was a Curtis Mayfield song or what you were doing on that show, but you just sounded so great.
We had a lot of fun.
Happy.
Yeah, ironically, and I always enjoyed doing covers, and we threw covers in on the albums. You know, over the years, we did a bunch of covers. Ironically, I am now one of the most covered guys in cover bands. And wherever I go, people come up to me and they go, hey, Greg, my band did the breakup song. Apparently the breakup song is one of the most covered songs for all the bar bands in the world. And people come up to me every day like, hey, dude, my band used to do the breakup song. And they'd always say, and people loved it. And they'd, you know, bring the house down. So ironically, I guess karmically, see, I was covering the Yardbirds and Gene Pitney and all this weird stuff. And oh God, man, we were covering, I did a Buddy Holly tune and we did a Hot Chocolate song, whatever we liked. And karmically, that set us up for being one of the most covered bands. In fact, in the movie, The Groomsman, the song that's in the movie that they're learning in the garage when the garage band gets back together again is the breakup song. So there's, you know, and that's John Leguizamo was singing lead vocal, and it was a bunch of comedians. Well, I forget who was in the movie, but it's The Groomsman, and there they are doing the breakup song in the garage, just like I did it in our garage. So it was kind of cool. That was one of the most covered songs, and Jeopardy got around the block a few times too, including Weird Al. Let's not leave Weird Al. When he parodies you, you know you've arrived.
That must have been a good feeling.
And what a great feeling. I got to make a cameo in the man's video. It was beautiful. Plus, Weird Al is a sweetheart.
So, Jeopardy, I mean, was there, did you think about it as a dance song right at the beginning?
No. Steve Wright had bought one of these brand new Casios that just came out, and they were just the first ones out, and had a little drum machine in there, and it had that beat in there. And he just started playing, and it just popped into my head. I started singing Our Love's in Jeopardy spontaneously. That song took 15 minutes to write. That's another one. But isn't that amazing? And it was that cheesy sound that of that clavinet and the drum machine. When we went to actually do the cut, we were using real drums and a real clavinet. It didn't sound the same. And we wound up mixing some of that cheesy Casio clavinet in there to give it that doinky doinky kind of sound.
And people love it.
Yeah, man, that was a good one. And you know, I just a little addendum to that. If it hadn't been for MTV, I don't think that Jeopardy would have been the big hit that it, I mean, you know, mega hit that it was worldwide. MTV jumped on the video because it was the only concept video at the time. Most videos were live or fake live. And this was actually something that like, had a story. It was fun to watch. It was like Night of the Living Dead. You know, people dug it. And it was the only one like that. In fact, that inspired Thriller by Michael Jackson shortly thereafter. But at the time, it got tons of airplay because of the fact that it was different. And, you know, we were in the right place at the right time for that one. And Jeopardy, of course, the fact that we had a great video was worldwide.
Right, it was all over the world. I mean, that must have been something to be internationally known.
Oh, man, I remember that year, 83, I won the MEDAM Award for International Artist of the Year, got the ASCAP Award for Most Performed Song. We're at the ASCAP Awards. Me and Steve Wright are down there, and here comes Quincy Jones. And Steve, me and Steve are sitting there. You know, we had our monkey suits on. We had just come from the ceremony. Doc Severinsen and the Tonight Show Band played Jeopardy. What a great moment. And they did a great version of it because they were the band for the ASCAP thing. And they did all the top 10 nominees and all that stuff. So I'm sitting there and behind me, Stevie Wonder, who's blind. I figure he doesn't know I'm there. And here comes Quincy Jones. And he's walking right towards me. So I stood out of the way. He came up to me. Because I figured he was going to go talk to Stevie. And he comes, hey, dude, I wanted to shake your hand. I love your song. It blew my mind. I said, I thought you were going to talk to Stevie Wonder. He says, no, man, I love your song. You know, those ASCAP awards were fun. I remember meeting a lot of my fellow songwriters there, and it was just a kick.
That's great. Well, yeah, you know, and I guess the money wasn't bad.
Oh, no, those ASCAP checks were big and fat and wonderful, and I leached on them like a tick. I lived on that money. I mean, that was wonderful. I remember filling out my income tax year after year going, look at all the money. And we, of course, back then we called it mailbox money. Right. Look at all the mailbox money. And you know, this is the beautiful thing. Over the years, I mean, this is why I love ASCAP. Over the years, those checks have continued. You know what I mean? They've tapered off. They're not in six figures anymore. But you know, they're solid. It's like having another job. Quarterly, they come in. You know, they roll in like clockwork. And you know what? I put two kids through college on those ASCAP checks. It's been very, very good to me. And I love the fact that even though I guess my stuff is classic or oldies now, it still gets airplay around the world. I'll get, you look over your international statement, and you see you got played in Israel and Tokyo and all kinds of crazy places, Poland. You know, they still love your music around the world. And I love the fact that I still get those checks. And you know what? After I'm gone, hopefully, that's a legacy I'll pass on to my kids. You know what I mean? Like, you know, Dad wrote those songs and we're still getting checks on them. So it's the wonderful, it's the miracle of ASCAP.
So you know, after Jeopardy, you had a couple more big, you know, not as big, but other radio hits, you know.
Yep.
Lucky and
right.
Reunited, I guess we should have.
Yeah, Reunited should have been a number one record, but I think we were changing labels. That happened to us a lot. Or a guy would sign you to a label and then he'd get fired and suddenly you were yesterday's papers. That's what happened at EMI. I've been through every conceivable thing that can happen to a rock band and a record company. You know, we've been dumped, we've been heralded, we've been signed for fat money, we've been signed for chump change, we fought with them, they loved us, we've done everything that you can do. And over the years, and I think this is very important, and you can thank Joel Turtle for this, but we've gotten back all of my stuff over the years. I now own my entire catalog. And I can, and it, by the way, I put it all out and it's all available on iTunes or, you know, gregkihn.com. We put out the greatest hits CD. Each album in chronological order, we re-released, nicely remastered. And it's important to me to have that legacy. Like I said, you know, years from now, people will still be listening, hopefully, to that music.
So we're, you know, when it started winding down a bit.
Yeah.
Was it very upsetting and frustrating?
Well, you know, it could have been, but geez, I had such a great ride. I couldn't complain. How can you complain? You had a number one record. You had a handful of top tens. What the hell do you want? I mean, when it was all over, I was mad at myself for not socking away more money or making investments. It was more that I screwed up. I could have been retired by now if I had done things the right way the first time around. But, you know, it was a... No, I didn't get bitter about it. I mean, I was always moving forward. So when I stopped, when the hits stopped coming, that's what about the time I got into radio. And, you know, it was like the second stage of the rocket blew off and suddenly I was in radio land for 17 years.
So how did that, you know, just audition or what happened?
I was filling in for somebody. Somebody was on vacation. They were gone for a week. So I just came in there. I filled in for the 7 to Midnight guy. After the week was over, the boss came up to me and he said, "Hey, you want to do 7 to Midnight?" And I said, "Yeah, why not?" And it gave me enough income to get off the road, get off the treadmill. A year later, they offered me the morning show, and I turned it down initially. John Sutherland was the GM at the time. And he wrote down a figure on a piece of paper. He goes, "I said, I can't do it, John. I can't get up at 4 in the morning. I just can't. Actually, 3:30. I can't do it, man." And he writes it down and he shoves it across the desk. He says, "Would you do it for this much?" And went, "Okay. What time do you want me to be here?" And, you know, I was supposed to be a fill-in. I was supposed to be, you know, temporary, but 17 years later, I was still there. It's an amazing run when you think about it. How could, and you know, I made this, the San Jose Rock Hall of Fame. I made the Bay Area Radio Hall of Fame. It's hard for me to look back and have a negative feeling about all the wonderful people, you know, and just like George Bailey.
You did two very nice albums, Horror Show and Mutiny, that I think are great.
I love those.
Greg Kihn, and they were so tasteful, and you must be one of the only artists to cover Eric Von Schmidt twice.
Yes. Eric Von Schmidt twice. Not once, but twice. I first of all, I love Eric Von Schmidt, going all the way back to my folky days.
Yeah.
And, of course, the folk blues of Eric Von Schmidt was standardized. You had to have a copy of that. That and Freewheelin' and Folk Singer with Dave Van Ronk. You had to have those three albums. And I just love that stuff. You know, I did a cover version of Gwabi Gwabi,
right,
which is, you know, to me, those two acoustics albums were a labor of love. That was just fun.
Belted.
You know, and I knew I wasn't trying to make hits. You know, I wasn't trying to make it. I was just doing the things that I felt that I'd wanted to do but never got a chance to because I'm in a band and we rock.
And this was a guy out in Baltimore.
Yeah, a guy I grew up with, Jack Hierman. Jack, we went to high school. He's always been a friend of mine, lifelong friend. And, I think the idea started when Joel and I were starting to make an acoustic album. And then Jack came along and said, why don't you come back to Baltimore and we'll make it here. He has a studio there. And a lot of really good Baltimore musicians. Man, it was a great Wal Matthews on guitar. And it was great. Alita Green on vocals. It was high class stuff. We had a ball. Now, ironically, my dad was dying. And I was going back in Baltimore and staying for a couple of weeks at a time. My dad was in the hospital. And I was working on Horror Show at the time. And I remember that because it did kind of color the album a little bit. It got a little dark in there from time to time. But, you know, I look back on those albums. Some of the songs I was writing at that, I don't know what I was smoking at that time, but I'd like to find some more of that stuff. Because I was writing stuff like Noah, yeah. And,
the anniversary of my book.
Really? When was the last time I wrote a country song like that?
A really good country.
I wish somebody would, you know, somebody like Dolly Parton would cover that. It's just got that groove.
I love it.
I wrote a lot of songs in that period that I hoped would get covered. You know, country songs and... songs like basic folky kind of songs that I hoped somebody would come along and cover.
You did a great job with Mutiny on the Bounty. I love that.
Love that song. You know, that's one of my favorite stories. And if you read the Mutiny Trilogy by Nordoff and Hall, I mean, it's three books, Mutiny on the Bounty, Men Against the Sea, and Captain Bligh. No, Pitcairn's Island's the third one. And the story is epic. You know what I mean? They go to Tahiti. They have the mutiny. They return to Tahiti. Bligh gets in a longboat and goes all the way 2,000 miles across the ocean, gets picked up by another English ship and winds up going back to England, goes before the Admiralty, gets they send him out to get Mr. Christian. And unbelievable. I mean, what a great story. A good story, good song, huh?
Yeah, absolutely. I just felt that it was very inspired and almost like a little bit of a return to your Baltimore coffee house.
Yes, very much so. And I was in Baltimore at the time, hanging out with some of the same people from those coffee house days. That album I was really proud of because I thought that it was a kind of a thinking man's album. I mean, you had songs about Cézanne and Van Gogh and Gauguin and Anastasia.
Right.
And those were thinking man's albums. I'm still proud of those. And I occasionally do some of that stuff in my Greg Kihn Band rock set. I'll open up with a couple of acoustic songs. Like we did Blood Red Roses into Mutiny on the Bounty. And it was just perfect.
Wow.
So I still do some of that stuff.
I'm glad. I hope you do it again.
Well, you know, I think we're going to, as time goes by, I'm incorporating more and more of everything I do into my live show. And in the future, I think when you go see Greg Kihn, maybe a year or two from now, it'll be more like a one-man show where you have, you know, I may read from my book. I may read a short passage. I may do some funny bits. I may tell a story or two about the radio years. I'll do some acoustic songs. I'll do some electric songs. We'll show some video behind us. You know, we had arranged to have some old video running behind us while we were playing. And the show opened with me on American Bandstand. And I look like I'm 13 and Dick Clark looks like he's 25. It's unbelievable. But, you know, and people dig it because they, you know, they like to see that stuff. And it's, you know, I got so much, geez, I mean, we've been on Saturday Night Live. We opened for the Stones. You know, we've been on every TV show in the world, solid gold and, you know, everything that you can name, we did it. And there's video everywhere. So it'd be nice to have like a full figured show that, you know, a multimedia thing where you used all that and you really presented like a fun evening. You know, I think we're heading in that direction.
You've written, as you said, 4 novels now.
This will be my 5th. Rubber Soul is my 5th. Release date is September 3rd, 2013, and I'm real excited about it. It's a Beatles novel. So the Beatles are characters in a novel. And it's a ripper too, man. It's a good thriller. It's got a rip snorting ending there where they almost get killed. It's an interesting book. I think it's unlike anything you'll ever read about the Beatles. And I'm really proud of it. In fact, I'm working on the sequel right now, and that'll probably be out next year. Wow. Yeah.
You're a guy who never stops working.
Well, I tell you, right now we're developing this internet radio show, and we'll probably be up and running pretty soon. And this thing is a ton of fun because it's all the things I loved about doing radio without somebody telling me what to do. No boss, nobody over my shoulder. I'm playing the music I want. We're telling the stories. I knew what people loved about the K-Fox show. They loved the road stories, the backstage stuff. You know, they loved it, you know, the Spinal Tap moments. They loved the live music when I would jam. So I'm just taking all the best of that, and that's what this whole new internet show is going to be all about.
You're going to have guest stars?
Guest stars, interviews, live music. I got a lot of really unique ideas that I'll be doing for the first time. One of the things that we came up with was a talking blues. You know, like about once a week, I'll do a talking blues in this Bob Dylan vein. Well, I'll talk about what happened that week, kind of like that was the week that was. Except that we are equal opportunity rippers. I'm ripping the Republicans and the Democrats. I'm ripping everybody. I'm ripping Obama. I'm ripping everybody that shows up in the talking blues gets ripped. You know, and in fact, this week, there's a lot about Wiener. Wiener, Wiener, Magic Peener. It's a classic. But, you know, I'm going to be starting, we'll put these up, and I think there'll be little YouTube hits, because every week there'll be like an update, what's in the news, you know, with a funny slant and completely irreverent. I'm a full opportunity put-down artist.
Do you think you'll be recording again?
You know, we've been talking about it. My son, Rye, who's the lead guitar player in my band nowadays, has been real anxious. He says, Dad, let's get together and write some tunes, and we'll go in the studio and just cut some demos, see where it leads. So we're going to start working on some tunes here in the next couple of weeks. I would love to put out, you know, another album. That would be great. But at the same time, I understand, you know, you don't, it's a young man's game now. And it's you denigrate your brand when you put out albums that nobody buys. You know, you just keep putting them out like a vanity thing. I don't want to do that. So if there's interest, we'll put it out. If not, we'll probably maybe just put out a few songs for downloads, something like that. You know, everybody's worried about bootlegging and downloading. My answer is, well, just don't record. You want just skip it. You know, we don't have to. We said it all, man. We said it all in the 80s.
But you must still. Do you ever still write a song?
Oh yeah, Ryra wrote one the other day. You know, and I get the weirdest song ideas. They'll just come from anywhere. I wrote a song the other day, and it came into my mind. It was a country song, of all things, called 97 Losers Can't Be Wrong. And it's about this guy. He's got to go play a gig, and he needs 100 people to show up, and 97, because he's got to break even, 97 people show up, but they love him. And 97 Losers Can't Be Wrong.
Fantastic. Well, I think this has been great. I really appreciate you giving me the time and the place.
It's been a pleasure. I've enjoyed this interview.
I'm glad because I have two.
You wanna want me to play a song?
I would love for you to play.
All right, tell you what, give me a second to go grab the guitar. We'll get right back here and I'll lay one on you, man. Usually when I pick up a guitar, people expect me to do some Greg Kihn hit, you know, from the past. But you know, a lot of those songs were easy to sing when I was, you know, 26 years old. I'm a little older now, and some of those high notes are really getting hard to hit. But one song that I can still sing as good as the day I wrote it is the breakup song. So, we'd broken up for good. I'm gonna give you a special version, special, that you won't hear anywhere else. We'd broken up for good just an hour before. And now I'm staring at the bodies that dance across the floor. Cause they don't ride them like that anymore. They just don't ride them like that anymore. We've been living together for a million years. Now I feel so strange out in the atmosphere. Then the jukebox plays a song I used to know. I'm staring at the bodies that dance so slow. All right, cause they don't ride like that anymore. They just don't. Forget your past. Cause they don't ride them like that anymore. Yeah. They just don't ride them like that anymore. They just don't. No, they don't. No, no. Let's take it home. One, two, three, out. We were talking about Mutiny on the Bounty a little while ago, one of my favorite stories. And I mean, there are still descendants of Fletcher Christian living on Pitcairn's Island to this day. It's an amazing story. So why not we do a little Mutiny? Mutiny on the Bounty. In the key of metaphysical distress. Way down on Papa Ante, where the bounty has gone, they were crying for the captain, they were crying for the son. But he made it back to England, and the Admiralty. Go out and find Mr. Christian and bring him home to me. Yeah, mutiny the bounty. One man died, and some men cried, and some wouldn't make it to Tahiti. On the bounty. On the bounty. Oh yeah. Well, they were sailing on the high seas. They had to track him down to Pitcairn's Island, where the bounty ran aground. They cried one for the captain, they cried two for the crew, they cried three for the cruelty. They point the finger at you. Yeah. Mutiny on the seven seas, on a Majesty's ship called the Bounty. Well, some men died, some men tried, some wouldn't make it to Tahiti. On the bounty. On the bounty. Oh yeah. On the bounty. On the bounty. All right. Oh yeah. All right.